we're standing before him right now. And he will change us. We can't see him with our eye, but I tell you what, he quickens this mortal body. He quickens our spirit by the spirit that dwells in us. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. He makes alive and living everything in us and about us. Oh, glory to your name, Jesus. We don't have to wait to one day when we get over yonder. It's going to be wonderful when we step over yonder, as the old song says. But today we can know him and we can behold him and we can walk on this earth as we're in days of heaven already, as we're living out heaven already because of his glory that he's come to manifest in us and through us. Oh, thank you, Jesus, for the glory of your presence. Thank you, Jesus, for the river. Father, I just thank you. I thank you, Father, that we all just go deeper and 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 deeper till we behold you face to face, till we see you face to face. Father, the realms of your glory, the realms of your presence, Lord Jesus, your anointing. Jibilan, barakite, broshtele, masatale, nikleva, rishkola, reshele na masota, rakatele la basura. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we thank you for divine encounters tonight.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you for divine encounters, Father, that take us outside of ourselves, take us outside of our comfort zones. Oh, thank you, Jesus. We praise you, Father, for encounters of heaven for every person. The encounters of heaven. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. We've come to encounter you, Father. We've come to behold you. We've come to see you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord Jesus, we thank you. We thank you, Father, for the Father, Holy Ghost, and the Son that lives on the inside of us. And the power and the authority that you've given us to be the sons of God, to be called the sons of God, to live out the realms of glory. Praise you, Jesus. On the inside of you, on the inside of you, on the inside of you is the realms of glory. Praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Rivers of the Holy Ghost. Gele lundara. Gele andura bashila. Praise you, Father. Praise you, Father. Praise you, Father, for rivers. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for power and authority. Power and authority. That whatever we ask, it shall be done. 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 You know, I woke up early this morning and I began to pray and intercede for people. The Lord brought different people to my heart. And I began to pray and intercede. And I said, Father, we're going to have the manifest glory of your presence in this place like never before. And every person in this place that has got any kind of sickness or thing that has tried to hang on, it's going to be broken in Jesus' name. And I begin to call people out before the Lord and cry out to God for them. I'm like, enough is enough. You back off in Jesus' name. Lying demon of hell, you let go. We break the power and the lies of the enemy that he would try to put against God's people. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. You know, this is the body of Christ when we stand together and the Lord brings the different members of the body of Christ to us. And then we begin to intercede and we begin to cry out and we begin to pray that those yokes be broken. That the yokes be broken, that people are healed, that there's no more of this waiting. That when people walk into this place. There's such a glory of heaven because God's saints are pressing in for the realms of glory, that people are healed and set free by the power of the Holy Ghost as soon as they walk in this place. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Father. Vilata, Roshana, Ziketa, Zubad. Just set yourself to have an encounter with God tonight. Just set yourself to have an encounter. There's no need to wait till tomorrow. There's no need to wait to try to figure it out on your own. You don't have to wait to see what the doctor says or what he needs you to do. You can touch heaven and it can all be fixed right now. Right now in Jesus' name. Right now in Jesus' name. We thank you, Father, for power and authority that you've given your people in Jesus' name. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Glory to your name, Jesus. We thank you, Father, for rivers of the Holy Ghost. Every person. I think the best part of church is where everybody's participating in the Holy Ghost. I know it is. When we worship together, when we pray together, when we're reaching in and touching the realms of heaven together, when the pastor is ministering and we're touching heaven and we're getting divine encounters and the word's going forth and we just explode. You know, that's not an interruption when you explode in the realms of glory, because God makes his word real and living and alive and on the inside of you. People get excited about nothingness. They get excited over football games and basketball games and you know, this ride and that thing, and they scream and holler and yell and show out all this excitement, and then they want everybody in the church to be quiet. We're not interested in what everybody wants. We're interested in pleasing the Father and doing what the Father wants us to do. We're interested in making him happy. We're interested in him and him alone and no one else, and not what man would dictate to us, but what Father dictates to us, what Father would say to us. Oh, praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. You know, people get all caught up in etiquette and politically correct and all of that, on all that stuff. And you know, etiquette is important. It's important. But you know what? It just makes me sick. Etiquette makes me sick when it's a lie. I'd rather somebody be rude to my face, even, and speak whatever they think directly to me, looking at me and telling me what they think, instead of behind my back, rolling their eyes and whispering to somebody else, wouldn't you? But etiquette is you don't say it to their face, you stand there and you lie. You know, that's etiquette, you know, lie. That's rubbish. That is demonic. You know, etiquette in the truth. Jesus had the best etiquette. And he said, you serpents, you're of your father the devil, you scorpions, you liars. And he had the best etiquette. He had the etiquette of heaven. He had the etiquette he created. To be truthful. Always truthful in what we say. You know, and sometimes we need to reel our thoughts and our tongues in. And they're wrong, and we don't need to be saying things to people's face. It's our problem. We have to look in the mirror and go, okay, this is my problem, not their problem, because I'm the one that's having a problem. So that, therefore, it's my problem for the most part. But to have people that will speak into your life and will tell you the truth where you need to correct things, instead of going, I wish they'd get this right or whatever, but we'll just, you know, when it hurts. Because, I mean, everybody wants to make friends and wants people to like them. And, you know, I don't think there's anybody that just doesn't care whether people, if anybody in the world likes them or not. You want somebody to like you at least. But, I will tell you, after you've been in the ministry, you've been raised in the ministry, you get to this self-preservation place to where you have this little shield up, you know, a PK, preacher's kid. This is, and other people do this too. You have this little shield up where you think you don't care whether people like you or not, because you're walking around, you feel like in this bubble. But you do. You do. And the reason you have that is because of all of the stuff. Because as a preacher's kid, everybody thinks that you're supposed to do it all right and get it perfect. You don't grow up like everybody else does. Only everybody else grows up. And only everybody else is learning, you know. But we're all walking it out together. We're all learning. God tries every one of us. He works in every one of us. Even the pastor, he's bringing us into a deeper place of his perfection. Amen. Into a deeper place of his likeness continually as we yield to him. We're all growing. So it's not like us, you know, pointing fingers at each other. It's, you know, we need to draw those all back in. If we got something to say, we need to start picking right here. And just go, Lord, change me. Change me. So I love like you love. Because he loves. His goodness and his mercy and his love is so amazing. It's so amazing. It's amazing that he hasn't done another Noah's flood on this earth today or something like it. It's just his goodness. It's just his goodness that tolerates this mess, that tolerates all the hatred. But you know what he's thinking? He's thinking, pour out his goodness, show forth his love, and then maybe some will come. Maybe some will come. He gave us everyone a free will to choose. And he lets that sun shine on you every day. And he lets his rain come down upon your fields. He lets the blessings of heaven continually come upon you. Everybody that's breathing has a blessing from heaven. Because it's the breath of God. In hopes that with his love, because he loves, not because he hates anyone, because he loves. He only hates the evil. And his heart is that everyone come to him. And so he shows forth his goodness, and if we can just be like him, if we will just allow ourselves, because he's put that love of the Holy Ghost on the inside of us to work out everything in us to make us like him, and all we have to do is yield to it. All we have to do is yield to this gift that he's given us of the Holy Ghost to be like him, to be like Jesus, to be like Jesus, to love people that look ugly and obnoxious in the state that they're in. Just love on them. What's sad is when we can't love our brothers and sisters. And if we can't love our brothers and sisters, then we can't love the world. We can't. We can't go out there and we can't be like Jesus and reach out and get in, and get down into the gutter with them, or get down into their situation and love on them and bring them to Jesus. We're just a bunch of hypocrites. First, your family. Your church family. Loving like Jesus loves. Loving like Jesus loves. And you can think about how there's somebody you love, that you really love. And moms are really good at this. You know, some of you guys might not get it. But moms are really good at this. There's people that you love. You know, and a spouse, and I'm sure like Ruth Ann and Cade, man, they're going to just be protecting everything. Ruth Ann's going to be protecting everything about Cade, and nobody better mess with Cade, I guarantee you.
True.
I know. And it's like that, you know, mothers with children. Because love covers, right? That's how God is. That's how he is with us. He's looking at you, and he's like, come over here, baby. You're mine. That's how Father is with us. And that's how he wants us to allow his love to flow through. It's amazing. I know the Lord's even, you know, he spoke to me right in the middle of me having a conversation with somebody. He said, you treat them good, they're my kid. You know, because you know how times you can be busy and things can be going on and you just want to get stuff done. And I happen to be one of those get stuff done people, move on to the next. And you get a little short with people, and then you get ready to go, and the Lord goes, because you know what? You reap what you sow. And when you think about that part, you go, weep. Or I do, because I've reaped enough of what I've sown to not want to reap any more of some of those things that you sow. And so you yield to the Holy Ghost. You yield to the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You know, that's that learning the obedience. You know, and I say many times when somebody's got an issue with somebody else, and of course, you know, it's all mostly self-defense for the person that's coming with the issue with somebody else. I think, you know, I'm just like, you know, and you never had any problem? And you've never had some things that God's working out in you? You're not growing and maturing?
you didn't make any mistakes yesterday. We just love one another. It's that love. It's that love. Like Ruth and Kate have for each other. I mean, they're on the front row. They just got married, and you just can't get any better than that. And so, you know, I'm picking on them. But, you know, she's going to have every protection. And, I mean, if Kate did something wrong, she's still going to be out there fixing it, you know, and just putting it all together. It's the way it is. And Mama's going to be like that for the babies, for the children. You're going to correct them, but as far as everybody else knows, we got this all covered. You know, you're going to be dealing with it. And, I mean, it's good to deal with it. And God deals with us, but he deals with us in love, in total acceptance. Total acceptance as he's working on his kids. Yeah. When you're, you know, getting onto your child, it ends you not kicking them out of the house, especially when they're five. You know, they may get a little bit older and have to mature and grow up a little bit where you do kick them out of the house. You know, you may have to come to some strong love discipline there and just go, this is the way it is now. With me, I was always trying to keep them in the house. I'm like, I don't see where the Bible says you leave home till you get married, especially girls. You stay right here until daddy gives you away. And so, you know, we were sitting on that one. But, I mean, there may be that discipline, but when they're 5 years old, you bring in correction because you love them and you want them to grow up. You know, it's not condemnation. You know, and when Father corrects us through the ministry, it's not condemnation. It's direction. It's correction to bring us closer to the Father. Hallelujah. Because God has great plans for you. God has great plans for you. God has great plans for you. He has great plans for every person in this place tonight. Every person that's occupying a seat in this place tonight. He has great plans, and he wants to show forth his glory in you and through you. That's his plan. That is his plan for you, to show forth his glory. Oh, praise you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. I want to look over here in Daniel. You know what? I'm going to read a couple of verses in Psalms. Psalms 75, verse 6. This scripture hit me first thing this morning, and then my daughter-in-law posted it on Facebook. I happened to go on there to put a scripture up on Facebook, and I saw where she posted the scripture that, you know, was the first scripture I thought of this morning. For promotion comes neither from the east, nor from the west, nor from the south, but God is the judge. He puts down one, and he sets up another. And then in Psalms 113, verse 6, who humbles himself to behold the things that are in heaven and in earth? He raises up the poor out of the dust and lifts the needy out of the dunghill, that he may set him with princes, even with the princes of his people. Isn't that amazing? Yeah. Isn't it amazing how you don't have to be born into it? He lifts up the poor and the needy. He lifts up the cast out. It doesn't matter where you came from or who you were. If you'll come unto him and you'll let him have his perfect work in you, if you will yield and surrender yourself to him, he will lift you up and set you on high and show you great things and do great things in you and through you, and let his name be glorified through a man or a woman that is willing to say, yes, Lord, through a child that is willing to walk properly before the Lord. God will use you. And, you know, Joshy over here, there was a prophecy came on him Sunday, and I was all excited about it. But, you know, Joshy doesn't have to wait. He can go on his face right now, and he can seek God. The Holy Ghost that speaks through me doesn't care about the size. And he's not worried about what's up here in the head called the brain. He's worried about the mind of Christ. And as we seek him and we get raptured over in the realms of his glory, he can speak through any vessel. It doesn't matter if you're 4 years old and just learned how to have a decent command of the English language. God can use a four-year-old that is willing to let God. And when we train up a child and they're 4 and they're 5 years old and we train them in the house of God and we train them under the anointing, God can begin to use them at a very early age. Doesn't have to wait. You don't have to wait. You don't have to wait till you get bigger and stronger and taller and wider and whatever. You don't have to wait. You can say, God, use me now. God, use me now, because it's not by your ability, but it's by the Spirit. So you take what God's given you and you let it multiply by letting him use you with what you have. And it can be in the context of the service. You can jump up with just, here the sun sets free. And the next person can jump up and say, it's free indeed. I mean, who knows? But that's what the Holy Spirit's saying. It's his word, and all of a sudden it becomes alive in the service, because that's what Father's doing. It's he. It's he that makes the decision. But it's your will conformed to his will. See, there's a lot of people that God, he doesn't, he's not making their decisions. They're going the wrong direction. But he's in charge of what's going on. And he's going to bring judgment, and he's going to bring it to an end. His mercy is only extending the time. But there is a time that it will be dealt with. And we've watched it, we can look at it over and over in Scripture where God says enough's enough, and now this is what's going to happen. And we can see what happened with Israel. Israel came into bondage, went into bondage under Nebuchadnezzar. God raised up Nebuchadnezzar to rule over and take captive Israel because of their rebellion and their disobedience. Correction. Correction had to come. Because they were so rebellious. There had to be correction. You know why there had to be correction? Why God had to deal with it. He had to deal with it, and he had to bring the correction. He couldn't just wipe them off of the face of the earth and say it's done. Does anybody know why? Because the Messiah must come through. Hallelujah. Because the Messiah must come through there. And he must have a people that are going to wake up and hear. So he brings the correction and brings them under captivity and under bondage to bring that correction, to keep it from going deeper and deeper and deeper into sin and ungodliness and rebellion, stiff-neckedness. They were just hard-headed, rebellious people. And so he brought the correction. And I want to turn to Daniel. Chapter 2. And I'm just going to take up in here, it's when the Lord reveals in a dream things to King Nebuchadnezzar. Yeah. Actually, this is Cyrus. Let's see. And in the second year of the reign of Nebuchadnezzar, he dreamed a dream. And anyway, he has a dream. And isn't it amazing? Isn't it amazing that God reveals to someone outside of a Gentile, basically, that's what we would say, what he's going to do throughout time and history of kingdoms that are going to rise up? I'd say God's in control. He says what's going to happen to the kingdoms, how they're going to rise up, what they're going to do, how they're going to fall. Even gives him a dream of what's going to happen to him. But he doesn't know what it all means. And it takes the man of God that's listening to the Father to reveal the dream. And I just love how Daniel comes back to his brethren. We can just start in verse 16. And Daniel went in and desired of the king that he would give him time, that he would show the king the interpretation, because the king said, there's no wise men that can reveal my dream, so I'm just going to kill everybody. And so Daniel's like, okay, give me some time. Give me some time. So he goes back, and then Daniel went to his house and made the thing known to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And said that, you know, we need to pray that they would desire mercies of God, of heaven, concerning his secret, that Daniel and his fellows should not perish with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. Then was the secret revealed unto Daniel in the night vision. Then Daniel blessed the God of heaven. The secret revealed to Daniel in the night vision. And, you know, as I'm, you know, just listening to the Lord this morning, I just heard the Father say, you know, he desires to reveal what's going on to his church, the secrets. He desires for there to be those Daniels, those Shadrach, those Meshach, those Abednegoes, those people that will listen to his voice, those Elijahs and Elishas and on, and we could just walk through all the Old Testament. Ezekiel, Isaiah, he's looking for them. And you all qualify. You all qualify. And look here at Daniel. Daniel answered and said, "Blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are his. And he changes the times and the seasons. He removes kings and he sets up kings. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to them that know understanding. He reveals the deep and secret things. He knows what is in the darkness, and the light dwelleth with him. I thank you and praise you, O God of my fathers, who has given me wisdom and might and has made known unto me now what we desired of you. For you have now made known unto us the king's matter." And what did they do? What did they simply do? What did Daniel do? He went to his fellow brethren. He went to the three brethren, and four of them prayed and sought God, and God brought the answer in the night vision. All they did was seek the Lord. And the Lord brought forth the interpretation of the dream. I mean, that's a radical dream, and you can go and you can look at that deeper. It's a radical dream that he had, and God reveals this to a Gentile to take his people and bring them up and set them up on high is what happens. To give them position to rule. To bring them, as it says, he takes the poor and the humble. So, because, you know, Daniel, you know, he was a prince in Israel, but now he's a slave. He went into captivity like everybody else, and he's a slave. He's a servant. He's a wise man. He's in the king's house, and he's considered a wise man, but he's still a slave. He's in bondage. He's not free. But because the first reason he got into that place is because he was a man that sought God. Because God wouldn't have taken a wicked person and put him in Daniel's position. He had to be a man that his heart was after God to be able to even put him in the king's house and give him that wisdom to be where he was at then. And we, everyone, have been given the Holy Ghost. And everything that we need, all wisdom, all knowledge, all understanding, is in and by the Holy Ghost. And we can all walk in this realm of glory and be used of God in this hour and in this time, because this is a time that God wants his people to stand up like never before. Like never before. And be the Daniels, be the Elijahs, be the Isaiahs. Be the men and the women of God that will not bend, that will not bow, but will stand for the Almighty. Stand in his glory and stand in his presence. God is able to do whatever he wants to do in the kingdom of men, but his mercy postpones judgment. His mercy must fill out the plan of a time and a dispensation. But it doesn't mean that God's people sit back and wait for that. We're to be the hinderers of lawlessness, the ones that persevere and stand and hold up righteousness until he comes and he takes us out, till he comes for that church that is without spot or wrinkle. That church, Father, Father, we pray and we cry out for that church in Jesus' name. Father, in the name of Jesus, for that church that will not let spots on their garments that have been made whiter than snow, but will stand against every lying power of darkness and will not be denied, will not let sin run rampant over them any longer. Oh, Father. And we can look at Elijah. King sends after Elijah in 2 Kings chapter 1. He's wanting to know, the king of Syria is wanting to know, who in the world is telling on what's going on with me? You know, I might have Elijah and Elisha's story mixed up. Let me look at this. No, exactly. And the king of Israel, okay, so here it starts in verse 8. Let's start in verse 7. Therefore said he, take it up to thee, and he put out his hand. The king of Syria warred against Israel and took counsel with the servant, saying, in such a place shall be my camp. And the man of God sent unto the king of Israel, beware that you pass not such a place, for at this place the king of Syria will come down. They're coming down. And the king of Israel sent to the place which the man of God told him and warned of him and saved himself there not once, not twice, but many times. So now the king of Syria is confused. Every time the king of Israel knows what's going on. So there's a spy in the camp. And he says, okay. So he calls all of his men together and everybody that is up close that can know what's going on. And he says, okay, who's against me? What's going on? Who's the spy? Who hates me? And they said, and one of his servants said, none of us, my lord, O king, but Elijah the prophet that is in Israel tells the king of Israel the words that you speak in your bedchamber. Because there's a man of God that walks with God that knows what the enemy's about to do. And he makes the preparation and he tells the people, he tells the king of Israel to prepare himself. And the protection is there on the king of Israel because the man of God is doing what the man of God's supposed to be doing. He's listening to the Father. He's flowing and functioning in what God's calling him to do. He's not all out there mixed up and messed up in the world doing what the world's doing. He's hid over in the secret place, in the place with God, in the presence of the Almighty. His purpose is in the things of the kingdom and not in the things of this earth and this world. God's got a man. God's got a man that preserves a nation. God's got another man that preserves a nation. Hallelujah. This is what he's called every one of us to be. And I'm like, oh, Lord Jesus, I want to hear. I want to know. I want my ears in tune. There's so much that can distract you and keep you busy if you will allow it. There's so many distractions. There's so many things to try to detour you and keep you out of that glory and that realms of his presence and out of the church, out of the revival and the place that we're supposed to be functioning in and moving into. There's so many things that can bring the detour. You know, there can be a little strife and a little division bringing the detour. We don't want any detour. We want to be a men and women of God that listen to the voice of God and are doing what God's doing. It doesn't matter what everybody else is doing. Elijah felt all alone. He felt all alone. He didn't feel like there was another person on the planet at one point that was listening to the voice of God. He felt like he was the only one. God says, don't worry, I've reserved 7,000 that have not bowed their knee to Baal. I've got a people. I've got a remnant. And there's a remnant throughout this nation that must stand up now. That must stand up now. Not conform, not acclimate into what's going on and accept it. But swim up river. Go straight up tide against the current. And go, we're not going with the flow. We're going with the Holy Ghost. And I love what Elijah did, because the king of Syria calls for him. And he says, like, go find this guy. Go look him, go seek him out. And I mean, this is just too good to pass by. We just gotta go here right now. And he said, go find him. And he sent horses and chariots to go get him. And when the servant of the man of God was risen early and gone out, behold, and this is, we're in 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 15, in case anybody's not up with me. Early, behold, a host compassed the city, both with horses and chariots, and his servant said unto him, alas, my master, how shall we do now? What in the world are we going to do now? Look out there, Elijah. Look at now, what are we doing? We're in trouble. That's what he was saying. He was like shaken over what he saw. Elijah's like. And he answered, fear not, for they that are with us are more than they that are with them. Don't look at the seeing of your eye or the hearing of your ear. We live in a realm called heaven. We live in a realm called glory. We live in a realm where God is in control. We live in a realm where we're just doing Father's business. We're just here to do Father's business, and it's going to all work out just like he planned, as long as we're yielded over to this realm of his glory and this realm of his presence. It's going to all work out like he planned. If we tuck tail and run in fear, then he'll have to find somebody else and it won't work out. But if we stand and we fear not, it's all going to work out the way Father intends for it to work out. And Elijah prayed and said, Lord, I pray you, my servant over here needs some help. Open his eyes that he may see. And the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of the horses and chariots. Fire around about Elijah. Woo! Glory. Elisha. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I'm sorry I skipped Elijah and went over into chapter 6 and talked about Elisha. But anyway, thank you, Jesus. And when they came down to him, Elijah prayed unto the Lord and said, smite this people, I pray thee, with blindness. And he smote them with blindness according to the word of Elisha. And Elisha said unto them, this is not the way, neither is this the city. Follow me, and I will bring you to the man whom you seek. But they led them into Samaria. And it came to pass that they were come into Samaria, that Elijah said, Lord, open the eyes of the men that they may see. And the Lord opened their eyes, and they saw, and behold, they were in the middle of Samaria. And the king of Israel said unto Elisha, when he saw them, my father, shall I smite them? And he answered him, no. He said, and in verse 33, and he says, verse 32, he says, set bread and water before them that they may eat and drink and go to their master. And he prepared great provision for them when they had eaten and drank, and he sent them away, and they went to their master. So the bands of Syria came no more into the land of Israel. No more into the land of Israel. Because God had a man. Because God had a man that was willing to be obedient to God and stand his ground and not move. Not run in fear. Not come under whatever the enemy wants to dictate to a nation. Hallelujah. And to stand against the kings that would come against his nation. And somebody listening with their ear up to the Father's heart, listening to what's going on, listening to what's being spoken in heaven, so he could tell what the king of Syria was doing. So Israel escaped every time. Now Elijah's in 2 Kings chapter 1. And I love this, but it's about the the king sending unto Elijah 50 men that were supposed to come and take him. And he spake unto them and said, thou mountain God. The king said, come down. And Elijah, in verse 10, and Elijah says to the captain of 50, if I be a man of God, let fire come down from heaven and consume you. And the 50, consume you and the 50. And there came down fire from heaven and consumed him and the 50. Because that's what God was doing right then. Now, the disciples tried it later on, and Jesus said, you don't know what spirit you're of. It's not something out of your head. It's not something that you just, you know, you just pop up and do. Because that's not what I'm doing right now. I'm showing forth my glory. When Jesus was talking with the disciples in a different way, through loving kindness and tender mercies, I've come to lay down my life and die for these people. Now, this is the time that I've come to show forth my goodness and my mercy in another way. And so then they send another group of 50. And the same thing happens. Fire comes down out of heaven and consumes them. And then they tell the next guy to go, and the next guy don't want to go. He's like, what's the point of me going? They just all died. What are you thinking? You know, two is enough for me. I've got this figured out. They died, and then they died, and I don't want to die. But so anyway, he went, and he humbled himself, and he fell on his knees before Elijah. God's in charge. The people of God are in charge. God's in charge. God's going to do it. It may not be the way you think he's going to do it. Because we can look right over here to Mary and Luke. We can look over here and we can see how God, just like that scripture I just read, he takes the low estate of his handmaiden. In verse 46, and Mary said, my soul does magnify the Lord. Just a little poor girl. Just a girl, just a little girl. God takes just a little girl and he uses her to bring forth the promise, the Messiah. Just a little girl that's willing, not much older than you, Charity, just a girl that's willing that her heart is sought after God, that she's set her mind on God. She had to be just given over to that realms of glory and that realms of his presence for God to pick her. She had to be of the right lineage. And she had to be a young girl that her parents had raised her up in the things of God for her to seek after God, to where she knew how to get alone in the secret place. So when the angel of the Lord appeared to her and spoke to her, she could say, be it unto me according to thy word. She was trained for that day, for that hour, to be obedient to God. So when he came and he spoke to her, she would be willing to receive the word and not run and hide. She was brought up and trained. Parents, are you training your children to receive the word of the Lord and to stand and say, be it unto me according to your word? And to be the vessel of the Lord that God can use. He wants to prepare you now, not later. He wants to use you now, Joshie, not later. Every one of you in this place, little faith, he wants to use you now. So blessed by little faith. Man, she was just, the other day, we're at a birthday party, at my grandson's birthday party, and she, you know, they singing happy birthday to you, and she had to have the Jesus part all in there. She sang two Jesus happy birthday songs. And I was just, you know, so blessed, you know, and you think, oh, that's just nice, cute, sweet. No, that's a light. I was like, come on, Faith. Come on. Because that's a light of the gospel used to stand up for his glory. They had a lot of wonderful events at that birthday party. Somebody crashed, and we were able to run over there and lay our hands on them and pray for them and minister the gospel to them. You know, a bad crash. I mean, it was a, you know, big mess up over there. People were hurt, and we were able to pray for them. You know, just being there, whatever we're doing in our life, we're being about the Father's business, doing what God's called us to do. Hallelujah. Just being where God wants us to be and doing what he wants us to do. And that, it's very, very simple. And then let me read Mary here. And Mary said, my soul does magnify the Lord, and my spirit has rejoiced in God my Savior. This is a young girl, a very young girl. Listen to this. And the Spirit of the Lord is just coming out of her like a river. For he hath regarded the low estate of his handmaiden. For behold, from henceforth all generations shall call me blessed. Why? Because she was willing. Because she was willing to let God use her powerfully. For he that is mighty has done great things, and holy is his name. And his mercy is on them that fear him from generation to generation. You hear that? Mary had that established of fear in the Lord. That fear of the Lord, that what does the fear of the Lord do? The fear of the Lord hates evil. It hates pride. It hates arrogancy. It hates the evil way. It walks in humility. It walks with a contrite and broken heart before the Lord. It's never trying to do its own will or own way, but it's yielding over. It's yielding over to God and His way and His instruction. This very young girl had gotten a hold of that. This very young girl trained up and ready to take her position in the kingdom of heaven for eternity. It looks like the kingdom of earth to everybody around, right? That's why people live the way they live. They live what they do, what they want to do, because they're looking at the kingdom of the earth, not the kingdom of heaven. But we're here to fulfill the kingdom of heaven on earth. We're not here to live in the kingdom of earth and do it Satan's way. He's the prince and the power of the earth, of the world, but his day is numbered. And greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. He has no power over us, so why do we give it to him? So why do we allow him to have any place? Because he has no place, he has no power, he has no authority. It is broken. The blood of Jesus Christ does a complete work. It doesn't do a partial work. It does a complete work. The blood of Jesus Christ cleansed, purified, and set us free, broke the chains of bondage, set us out of darkness into his marvelous light. And in light there is no darkness, not one little bit of darkness in light, because darkness can't even show up when there's light. It can't show up. When you put the light on in the room, darkness flees. And you may say, well, it's under the bed. We'll shine the light under the bed. When Jesus comes, he shines the light all the way through and through. There's nothing left. So we simply give no place to the devil. And realizing that you're the one that gave him the place, just take it back in Jesus' name through the power of the blood, and don't give it back to him again. Oh, hallelujah. And his mercy is on them that fear him from generation to generation until Jesus comes back and it's all over and all fixed up. His mercy. He has showed strength with his arm, and he has scattered the proud in the imaginations of their heart. Those that would have thought that they would have been the one worthy for God to do that to, he wasn't about to use them. He goes to the low and the humble and the broken and the ones that would think that it was impossible, but those that stand and believe God and fear his name, but would look at themselves and would think that it would be impossible that God would choose them, not those that go, well, you know, God's going to choose me surely because I've you know, and just, you know, proud, stiff-necked people. And that's what Israel was. They were proud, stiff-necked people. All the scribes and Pharisees, they were so convinced that they had it all put together that they crucified their Messiah. They really had it put together. They were so caught up in themselves and in their pride and their arrogancy that their visitation came and they crucified him. Their Messiah came and they just couldn't wait to put him to death. That's what pride will get you. It started with Satan, and it's gotten him nowhere. He keeps thinking it's going to get him somewhere, but it got him nowhere. I love it when Jesus said, I see Satan cast down out of heaven. And I love it when he said, it is finished on the cross. And I love it when he rose from the dead and he made all things new. And I love it when he ascended up on high and he sat down at the right hand of the Father and he poured out the Holy Ghost so we could all do the same thing. Hallelujah. This is what we're living for. This is what we're living for. Church, stand up. Church, stand up and be the church. Church, stand up and glorify the Almighty God and be all that he's called us to be and live it and walk it out and let him show you his great things in the night visions. Let him whisper the secrets in your ear. Let him tell you about what he's about to do. Let him show forth his glory in you and through you and touch the nation of the earth. Because you know the Almighty and he lives on the inside of you and he's done a complete work and he's ready to use you if you're willing to let him. all about you giving yourself to him and saying, here I am, God. I mean, Joel stirred me up, man. He's like talking about his truckloads of riches, and you know, and he's like, you know, when the fire is put to it. And I'm just saying, oh, God, I don't want anything in me that when the fire is put to it, it's going to burn up. What are we doing? Are the things that I'm doing right now, are they things that are going to amount to the riches of the kingdom of heaven? Or are they going to amount to a pile of wood, hay, and stubble? Oh, man, that is not going to be fun, sitting there watching a bonfire. I mean, that one hit me really strong. I mean, I thought of it many times, but as the Lord brings those things back around and somebody speaks it, and then just that passion in Joel, you know, and the sacrifice that he has made. Because I'm telling you what, there's most people. I mean, I had an aunt that, or a cousin that had the kidney failure, and she went through the dialysis and the pain and the horrendousness of the dialysis, and we watched her body swell up, and we watched her die, and we watched her go through all of that stuff. And it was misery. And to watch Joel get out of bed. I mean, she was laid up so much of the time, she just didn't have the strength to move. And watch Joel get up and go and not allow this body to dictate to him what he's going to do, but living over in the realms of heaven, living over in the realms and the purposes of heaven and doing what God's called him to do, regardless of what the enemy would try to do against him. And I'm going to join him kicking the devil. Because, I mean, he's messed so many people up. It just, you know, I was right there with him. Come on. I was like, come on, let me get up here and help you. But just seeing him, is there anybody in this place that has gone through and fought a battle as much as Joel has to preach the gospel, to stand up and declare the gospel? We all should be ashamed of ourselves. He's going to be out ahead of us. Unless we get to running, get on them track shoes, and get to running for the kingdom of God, get to running for the gospel of Jesus Christ. I just thank you, Father, right now for healing Joel completely. Because if a man will do what he's doing with what he has to deal with, what can that man do when he's completely healed? And the glory that is seen, Father, the glory that is seen as Joel is completely healed. Lord, the test should be long enough, and now the testimony, oh God, where the glory of the Lord is just shown through Joel being healed. Thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. That's what we want to see. We want to see the glory of the Lord. We want to all be praying heaven down and the glory of heaven down when we walk in this place. We're all in it. We're ready to move out in God. Every one of us, we've got something in God. We want to lay our hands on somebody and see him healed, because God's been revealing to us what he's going to do in the church. And we're ready to participate and be the body and move out and function in the Holy Ghost. We're preparing ourselves. When God says he's going to do something, he begins to lay stuff on our heart. We don't go, yeah, 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 Lord, and go on about our business. But we take the time to pray and to cry out to God that it's done. See, when we hear something in the Spirit, when we hear God say something, then it's time to pray. Because he needs us to pray. He needs us to cooperate with what he's doing. He needs us to connect up with what he's doing and pray and command it to be done. See, Daniel went to seek the Lord. And he fasted, and it took 21 days for the angel to get there. And the angel said, he said, I would have come in the very beginning when you separated yourself to seek me, but Satan hindered, and there was a battle. But when we pray, when God's people pray, the hindrance has to get out of the way. Paul was continually saying, pray for me. Pray for me. He would have gone in and come unto, I forget who he was going to. But anyway, anybody can help me if you remember. But he said Satan hindered. And so he was continually telling the saints to pray, that utterance might be given to him, that the hindrances would be broken. Because we have a job here on earth to pray, and the battle gets won in the prayer. The battle gets fought in the prayer. That's why it's important to show up for prayer. When there's prayer, we're pushing back. We're pushing back. We're the enemy. Is trying to take hold. We're pushing back. Prayer breaks every yoke. I want everyone to stand with me right now, and I want everyone to pray and agree with me. that every hindrance that the enemy would try to throw out. Because the enemy, he always wants to throw at us hindrances. That every hindrance that the enemy would try to be thrown out will be confounded, will be broken. It will come to naught in Jesus' name. It will come to nothing in Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus. Together, we're standing with one heart, with one passion. Believe me, people, when you get in it, when you jump in this boat, there's power and there's authority when we stand together in the name of Jesus and we believe that God will get the job done and the hindrances of the enemy that would come out against us are broken in Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus, we thank you, Father, that you're having your perfect work and you're doing your perfect thing, and we stand in the realms of your glory and the realms of your presence, and we will do what you've called us to do, Father. We will fulfill what you've called us to fulfill in Jesus' name, and every hindrance broken in Jesus' name. We thank you, Father, right now. In Jesus' name, in the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you, Father God, that your glory is revealed in this place. Father, that your glory is revealed in this place. And every hindrance that would come out to oppose it, Father, is broken in Jesus' name. Every hindrance is broken. Father, your glory revealed. Father, your people standing up and being the men and the women, God, that you have called them to be. That you have called them to be, Father. We thank you, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. Father, we yield ourselves to you, oh God. To do everything that you've called us to do, Father. Surrender. We surrender ourselves right now. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Every hindrance broken. Every hindrance broken. Every hindrance broken. Every hindrance broken in Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus. No destruction. We thank you, Father, for a people, Father, that will surrender themselves to you, Father God, and stand up and be mighty. Father, through you, through the Spirit that rules and reigns in our life, oh God. Jenna, we'll let you have full control, Lord Jesus. We won't do it our way, but do it your way, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, we thank you, Father. It is done, Father. It is done in Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus. Your perfect work, oh God. Your perfect work, oh God. We thank you, Father God, that we believe what we pray and we receive what we ask. Hallelujah. We receive, Lord. We receive, Father God, in Jesus' name. Praise you, Father God. Hallelujah. Father God, I praise you, Lord Jesus, that every person in this place, Lord, just take a hold. Just take a hold of the word that you have spoken by your Spirit, oh God, and let the change come. Let the change come in their life. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. Now, I want everybody to continue to pray, but I want to ask anybody that wants prayer for any particular thing to come forward, and especially those that have been pressing in for healing. You've seen the Lord touch you and heal your body, but there's still some things hanging on. People that have not been completely healed of something. Now, not that you're not standing in faith and believing that it's done, because you come up here every time and you believe that it's done, but there's some things still hanging on. I want to pray for you. And I want everybody to stay in the realms of his presence, and we're doing this together. We're doing this together. We're doing this together. We're pressing in. We're going to see. We're going to see people healed and come from the east to west and north to south. Come into this place because the healing power of God is in this place. And people are healed instantly. Because we're going to be a church that believes. We believe and then we receive whatever we ask. We believe it and we receive it. In Jesus' name.